So let's start today's session. So the classification by Naveen Bayesian algorithm. So Naveen Bayesian is one of the important algorithm, and Naveen Bayesian algorithm is used for statistical learning. So the statistical learning is built upon the mathematical probability theory, and we treat the data as some examples taken from the using the random variable which describe the domain. So we call them the evidences, and so it means all the examples that we consider, so we call them evidences. So all of these in today's lecture we will go through the various terminologies which are specifically for the Naveen Bayesian algorithm and statistical learning, and we will also go through the a particular example to understand the full concept and why do we call it Naveen, why that this Bayesian theory is called the Naveen. So hypothesis, again we have already used this terminology. So the probabilistic theory of how the domain works, so ultimately what outcome is the one hypothesis which says that how the this domain works. So it means we will try to learn hypothesis from the data. And this Naveen Bayesian algorithm is the strongest algorithm in the statistical learning. And even if we consider all the classification algorithm, so the optimal solutions are given by the statistical learning based on the training data. So it always depends how your training data is, and based on training data, it gives the best results. Now to understand it, we start with an example. Let's say you have two flavor of candies, and the cherry flavor and the lime flavor, and you got five possible bags which can come to you from the market. So we, let's say these are H1, by saying these are hypothesis, H1, H2, H3, H4 and H5. So in the bag one, which could be one of the possibility that all the candies are cherry candies. So probability of finding cherry candy is one, and probability of finding lime candy is zero. So in the bag two, there are 75% cherry candy and 25% lime candy. Obviously, so this number also tells you that what is the probability is 75% probability to get cherry. If we pick out one of the candy out of this bag, so there is 75% chances are it is cherry candy, and 25% chances are that is lime candy. Similarly, bag three has both 50%. Bag four, or we call it as hypothesis four, H4, it has 25% cherry candy and 75% lime candy, and bag five has 100% lime. So let's say these are the five possible bag which are indistinguishable from outside. Now let's say one bag is given to you and you are supposed to take out one candy, and based on by looking at the candy, can we guess the bag? Let's say if it comes out to be a lime candy, so what could be our guess? So this is the kind of problem that we actually address in the statistical learning. So these functions are given to us, and based on that we have to learn that what happens when we pick out one candy out of these bags. We don't know from outside that which of these bags are there, and then based on we keep on taking one example at a time, that is we keep on taking one candy at a time and try to build our hypothesis. So in the next slide, we will discuss about this problem thoroughly. So these are the bags H1, H2, H3. So these are the bag given to us, and now given a new bag. So random variable H denotes a bag. We don't know which bag it is. So we don't know which bag has been given to us, and then we pick up one candy. So DI is the random variable. So in classification, it will be our one example. We don't know whether it, to which our example belongs. So cherry and lipes are the supervised label of that example. Now after looking, let's say n candies, so let's say I keep on picking up one candy at a time. So one problem is what is the outcome that, or what is the flavor of the next candy? So this is one problem. So this is what we want to find out. I have taken out n candies out of the bag. And now you want to predict the flavor of the next candy. So what is given in this problem? So first thing is the hypothesis prior. So what is prior is, let's say if from market we ordered this bag, the chances for H1 that to come is 0.1. So that is if I ordered 10 bags, so there is only one chance that H1 will come. Or if I order 100 bags, so out of 100, 10 bags will be hypothesis 1, 20 bags hypothesis 2, 40 bags hypothesis 3, 20 bags of hypothesis 4, and 1 bag of hypothesis 5. So this prior information is available to us. So before we start working on our example, so this is a prior information, not data. So what is data? I have started taking candies from the bag. So I've started taking, let's say I've taken these candies and all the candies comes out to be a lime candies. So I have taken few candies, all of those come out to be lime candy. So what is the probability that it is H1? Obviously, if all of those are lime candy, so probability of H1 to be 0 because there is no lime candy in this. But still there is probability of H2, H3, H4 and H5. Chances for H5 to be very high. So probability that this bag belongs to H5 is very high. Now after seeing the first candy, we have to predict the flavor of, one is a predict hypothesis, that is what is a bag. And after seeing one candy, we have to predict probability of the next candy to be lime candy or cherry candy. So these two problems are solved using this. Obviously we can solve, these two problems are linked to each other. If we have solved one problem, we can also solve the second problem. So again, I state the problem that you go to a bag from the market, you take out some candies out of that. You know that the prior probability, you know the prior probability of bag to become. And even without looking at a candy, since you know the prior probability, you still have some information that what is the probability of even the first candy to be cherry or lime. Then after seeing first candy, you have to find out, or after seeing some few candies, you have to find out the probability of hypothesis to be H1, H2, H3, H4 and H5. And similarly, after seeing few candies, you have to predict the next candy. After seeing D1, you have to predict the flavor of the next candy. So this is the problem that we want to solve in the Bayesian algorithm. So now why Bayesian classification? Because it is a statistical classifier. So proved mathematical theory. So in earlier all the algorithms, if you remember, we have used the greedy approaches. So those are based on heuristic. So anyone who propose a better heuristic, our algorithm now changes based on the new heuristic. But this is a proven theory. So this is a mathematical base behind it. So it is based on Bayesian theorem and its performance is as good as your training data. So if you go to some training data, so based on training data, the best performance is given by the Bayesian classifier. Today we will discuss why do we call or how to develop the Naive Bayesian classifier. And it has a comparable performance with decision tree and others. Even though it takes initial time to build up, it is always incremental. So you keep on taking more examples, your algorithm will start improving better. So more and more examples, so your algorithm will improve. Better is the prior knowledge. So your algorithm can use this prior knowledge to improve the outcome of the final outcome. It can be improved. And it is a standard model. So even though we call the Bayesian theorem computationally intractable, that is, it is NP time computationally intractable, because as you keep on increasing the parameter, so Bayesian method becomes very complex. So, and to find the optimal decision, so it becomes very complex. So that's why we have to move from Bayesian to the Naive Bayesian. So Naive Bayesian is one of the modification. So we will see today that why it is called Naive. So it is one of the modification just to reduce the computational complexity. Otherwise, the Bayesian theorem is very computational complex. So as we increase the parameters, it keeps on increasing the complex. So the basics, we will go through the terminology and try to develop what actually we want from a Bayesian theorem. So each example, so let's we term it as X. So each example, each data sample, we also call it as evidence. So for each example, so we have, if it is evidence and class level is not known, and H is the hypothesis, which says that X belongs to a class C. So when we attach class label to X, so it becomes one hypothesis. So classification is to determine probability of hypothesis, that what is the probability that a hypothesis is there. So hypothesis is the labeled class attached to X. The probability that hypothesis belongs to a observed, that holds given observed data sample X to a particular class. The prior probability should be known to us. For each hypothesis, the prior probability known to us. So initial probability. So here the algorithm starts from the initial probability. So let's say for each class, we need to know the prior probability. So remember in earlier algorithms, we do not have any information about the prior probability, but here we go with the prior probability. That is, if there is a class, so regardless of any attribute. So remember the same example, X will buy a computer. We should have some prior probability information. And probability that sample data is observed. So this we get it from the training data. And then we have to find out probability of X given hypothesis. So this is called the posteriori probability. So probability of observing the sample. So probability of observing the sample given that the hypothesis holds. So given that X will buy a computer. So the probability that X is between a income a range of 31 to 40,000. So that if it is given to us, so based on that, we try to find out. So these information should be given to us. And based on that, we will try to find out this value. So here we will use the Bayesian theorem. So this is a typical Bayesian theorem. So you want to find out the probability of hypothesis. You know that you observe the X, you got a new test data, and you want to predict the class or hypothesis of that. So what you need to know, the first parameter, so probability of X to be in that hypothesis, probability of X that to be in a, that particular example, that particular class, probability of all the classes, and probability of that X to come. So this is a normal Bayesian theorem. So we will work through this today. So you need to remember these terms. So this term is called the posteriori. So this definition you need to remember. So likelihood. So this part is called the likelihood. So likelihood is, so probability of X to be in that hypothesis. So again, to understand, again, go back to our surprise candy example. So there we have five hypotheses possible. So it means there are five classes possible, H1 to H5. And our example can belong to either lime or cherry. So we observed one example, lime. So probability of lime to be in H1, probability of lime to be in H2, probability of lime to be H3, probability of lime in H4 and in H5. So that is likelihood. And prior probability of each bag. So what is the probability to get a particular bag? So that is the probability of hypothesis. Divide by the evidence. So in all the training example, what is the probability to observe that particular example? So that is our evidence. So from that we try to build our algorithm. So we want to predict X belong to class C2 if the probability of C, so hypothesis is nothing but the class. If the hypothesis, if the probability of C2 for X is the highest among all the classes. So what we will do is we observed a test set X. We try to find probability of C1 by X, then C2 by X, then C3 by X. And we predict X belongs to a particular class for which its probability comes out to be highest. So that is our final goal in this case. So what are the main practical difficulty? You require initial knowledge. So this prior information that you want of all the probabilities, and you also need to know the likelihood of each. So likelihood that you can calculate from training examples, prior you need to know, prior may be given to you, or the evidence again taken from the training examples. Now let D be a training set given to you. So you got some training set as in the other classification algorithm, and the class label is attached to them. So we know that what are the attributes, and class label is attached to that. And each tuple is represented by n dimensional attribute vector. So there are n feature in each particular example, and the class label, the CI, is attached with each of them. So let's say we have m classes. So any of these m classes is attached to the this our attribute vector x. So we will now need to check the probability of each of class c1 by x, c2 by x. For each class we can use this Bayesian theorem to calculate probability of each of the class, and then we will predict that into which class x belongs. So what we require is this value, and this denominator. Now look at this px will is going to remain constant for all classes. So when something is constant, and so that can be removed from the denominator part, because you are, when you are comparing probability of c1 by x, so you are calculating probability of c1. Again, you have the same denominator. For a probability of c2, again you have the same denominator. So why not to remove this? Because it is not going to change our final outcome. Our final outcome now based on the only numerator part. Only numerator need to be maximized. So this is the first step we move towards a naive Bayesian. The first is denominator is removed. So probability of x is not now counted. So this is the first step that we move towards a naive Bayesian. Second step is, if we assume all the prior information to be equally likely. If I say that all the classes are equally likely, so that is probability of C1 is equal to probability of C2, C3, C4, then we can also remove this one. So if I also remove this one by taking assumption that probability of each class is same, then I left with only this one. So I can reduce the complexity. But in actual naive Bayesian, we do not remove this part. So we will see that. So another assumption that we take is all the attributes are conditionally independent. So by considering this, so when we are taking the x1 attribute, so when we are calculating, so this particular theorem, so when I am taking the x1 attribute, so probability of to calculate x, if I assume each to be independent, I have to just multiply this. So probability of x1's CI, probability of x2, and so on till xn. X1 could be any attribute, age attribute, x2 could be income attribute, so on. So since we are assuming conditionally independent, again this assumption makes it a naive Bayesian. So first assumption that we had taken is we have removed the denominator part. Now we are using conditionally independent. So when you assume all the attributes are conditionally independent, which may or may not be true, but if you have taken this assumption, then it becomes a naive Bayesian algorithm. So this reduces the complexity. Actually, in actual Bayesian theorem, we do not assume this, and that increases the complexity of normal Bayesian theorem. But here, because of this assumption, our algorithm becomes very simple. Now we have to calculate probability independently and then just multiply. In last lecture also, so I've told you whenever you have to multiply these many probability, because each probability is coming out to be a fraction. So maybe this is 0.5, so next maybe value 0.3. So when you have to multiply these many fraction values, it is better to take the log value. So rather than multiplying so many floating point values, which can again increase your complexity, we just take the log. So ultimately we will take the log value and we will take the log, maximizing the log likelihood. So log of each of the probability, and then we add that value. So further, whenever we have to take the probability, if attribute is categorical, so obviously the number of tuple in C1 divided by the total number of tuple, so that gives you the probability. But if it is continuous valued, so then you have to calculate the probability using the Gaussian distribution. So Gaussian distribution will give you the actual probability value if it is a continuous value. Even though I would suggest that you change the continuous to categorical, you discretize it and then use an Bayesian. But even if in a particular domain you still want to go ahead with the continuous, then calculation of probabilities by using the Gaussian distribution. And then you calculate the particular probability by using the Gaussian distribution value, using the mean value and the distribution standard deviation in that value. Now let's take example to understand this, because we will take actual data. So this example I have taken in decision tree as well. Let's say you have these 14 records are given to you. So in these 14 records, attributes are age, income, student, credit rating, and in last is the class level, which is the buying computer, yes or no. So last is the class level. So in fact, you have the four attributes. Total records are 14. And classes are yes or no. Bias computer, C1 class, yes. Bias computer, yes, is C1, and bias computer, no. So let's try to apply our naive Bayesian algorithm on this very small data set. So our data set, the samples are like the first example is age is less than equal to 30, income is medium, or in the first example it is high. Student is in the first example it is no. So student value can be yes, no, and credit rating is fair. So let's run our algorithm on this particular data set. So total records are M, total examples are 14. So total records are 14. Now, if we calculate out of these 14, how many of these belong to C1? That is yes. And how many of these belong to C2? So bias computer, so how many belong to C1? So this is the C1 class. So 9 we calculate from here. So probability of C1 to be 0.643. So this is one prior information. Bias computer, no, this is second class. So it is 0.357. So this we can calculate from the example data. So by just by looking where it comes yes, no, you can calculate the probability of C1 and probability of C2. So remember, this is the first part that we, this is the prior information that we want to calculate. So if you have multiple classes more than two, for each class, you will calculate this probability of C1, C2 and C3 and so on. Second now, so for each class and for different attribute, you have to calculate probability of X for each class. So probability of age less than 30. So what are the chances that age is less than 30 and bias computer, yes. So this is our C1 class. So what is the probability? So this is one C1. So remember, there are only 9 records which belongs to C1. Out of those 9 records, out of these 9 records, age is less than 30 only in 2 records. So age is less than equal to 30 only in 2 records. If you look at, so there will be 2 records where the age is less than 30. So this is one record and this is another record. So probability of age less than 30 and bias computer, yes, you got this value. Similarly, probability age less than 30 for C2 class. So out of 5, so C2 class only 5 records are there. Out of 5, 3 are those where age is less than equal to 30. So this is one record, this is second, and this is the third. So again, you calculate this for both C1 and C2 for particular attribute age. So you keep on doing for similarly for income, medium. Again, you calculate whether for C1, how many records are true. Similarly for income, medium, for C2 class. Student, yes. Student, yes, for C2 class. credit rating fair for. So in this way, you calculate these probability for each of the possibilities, each of the possibility for each attribute. Now let's say you got it some test data. So this is a test data, let's say you get. Now all this information is available to you, which you have already calculated. If you do calculate for other things as well, for probability for age 31 to 40 and greater than 40, for every possible value, you calculate these probability. So calculating these probability from the data, that is calculating this and this from the data, is called the learning from the data. Now for a particular test attribute, so you want to know that what is the probability for C1. So we know that probability of age 30 in the C1, so 0.222. So probability of income medium and C1, so this is this value multiplied. Probability of then student, yes, and C1. So this is this value and it is multiplied. Probability of credit rating fair. So this is this value. You multiply and you got one answer. Remember, you can also take log and then add. So the same thing you can do, or you can also multiply. In actual computer algorithm, we take the log and add these values. Similarly, you do it for no. Again, no. For all these value you get, and you now you got these two values, and you can compare, and based on probability which is higher, then you can predict that to be the your class outcome. So this is the way we use, this is how we use the this particular algorithm. So in this way, this particular algorithm is used. So this is very simple way of using it. So here I have assumed, so I have not used these particular prior probabilities. So in fact, these need to be multiplied in every case, and accordingly you have to multiply. So Bayes computer, yes, these probability need to be multiplied, this prior. So then this will be modified to this one. And in second case, again, prior probability need to be multiplied, and this is modified to this one. So if prior probability now determines what is the final outcome, and based on the final outcome, then you say Bayes computer, yes. So in many implementation, people, if suppose you got 1 million records. So 1 million record, even sometimes you do not want to spend in doing so. You say, assume that each class is equally probable. Then you need not to do this step. If each class is equally probable, you just go by the probability of X by CI. And second thing that we do in the implementation, we take the log and then add these values rather than multiplying. Because if you got many attributes, let's say you got 100 attributes, so 100 floating point multiplication can be very computational complex. And if you do not have that much precision to represent the floating point number. So now again, you have to do certain things. So this is very important concept, avoiding the zero probability. So it might be possible that, so when you are doing naive Bayesian prediction, so each conditional probability to be non-zero. Otherwise, the predicted probability will be zero, because since we are multiplying, or even if we are taking log value, log of zero is not defined. Let's say probability of certain class, so there is no record in the training set, let's say for particular class, let's say C3, so there is no record in the training set. So this may be because training set is not proper. So probability of C3 then comes out to be zero, since there is no record in the training set. So you have to avoid that, because otherwise if you multiply, so then that will make the whole product to be zero. So zero probability theorem says that you have to add one record for each of the class. For example, you got a data set of 1000 tuple and you got these attributes. So you use Laplacian correction. So income law, there is no record. So you add one record corresponding to income law. You have to avoid zero probability for any value, for each attribute and for each class, you have to avoid this. Otherwise, if any zero value comes, so in both multiplication or in the log, so it will create a problem. So this is something as a pre-processing step we do, and most of the algorithm or implementation, they do it themselves. But still you need to avoid this, you need to aware of this zero probability theorem. So the main comments, it is very easy to implement, as you have seen. So from the example, you can easily implement yourself. Once you got a data set, you have to calculate the probabilities. You know, need not to look at any of the implementation. And results are very good, because whatever your training data says, so this is what Naive Bayesian says. So it is a statistical classifier. So mathematical theory is behind this. So whatever your training data says, so that is what the Naive Bayesian says. Disadvantage, the first, we have taken some certain assumption. We are not using the pure Bayesian theorem. So class conditional independence, if you are taking. So in our example, we have multiply with the class multiplication. So there is always loss of accuracy. And similarly, if we are considering attributes are independent of each other, so that is another assumption that we have taken. Again, that may reduce your final accuracy. So practically, we know that these dependencies exist between the variables and all those things. For example, hospitals. So there are patients, age, family history. So all of these are dependent on each other. And if there are symptoms, so all of these are like, if patient is having symptoms, so there is some ages, these symptoms are dependent on the age or family history. So usually in every data set, attributes are dependent on each other. So our assumption to consider them independent and then multiplying their probability may give us less accurate results. But usually we use Naive Bayesian when these dependencies are not very much clear to humans. Suppose you got a data set, you are not aware of these dependencies. So the first thing, you assume it to be independent of each other. And when in most of the cases, dependencies are very difficult to model. So that's why even if we are not considering, so these are not considered in the Naive Bayesian. But still, these assumptions that we have taken, so these assumptions may reduce the final accuracy. Now, how to deal with these dependencies? Since if there are 100 attributes, so you may say that, okay, I cannot find the dependency among the, all the 100 attributes. So it is very difficult to find dependency. But then you can say some human expert can tell me about some of the dependencies which are known to human experts. If human expert tell you about the dependencies, so how human expert will tell? They will tell using the Bayesian belief networks. So these are the same if you might have studied in the AI course as well. So human tells that how these are dependent. So Bayesian belief networks are where human tells how these models are dependent. So they can use a graphical model to tell, or they can write the formulas directly as well. So when we use graphical model, then it is easy to depict, and human expert can also tell the how much one is dependent. They can also say, oh, this is fully dependent, or this is only half dependent. So in this way, they can give you a network. So Bayesian belief network just add a layer of complexity to the Naive Bayesian by saying, in the Naive Bayesian, we are not considering these dependent. We are assuming that they are not dependent. But Bayesian belief network give us some dependence value. And using this, you can change the final answer. So once you have calculated your probabilities, you can change the final answer based on this Bayesian belief network. For example, you got this Bayesian belief network. Now, who has created this? So this network may be given by the human expert initially, but how much one thing is dependent on another, that may be learned. So even neural networks are nowadays used to learn these networks. But human expert, if they have some mechanism, they can give these weights. Now let's say if we have to predict something, suppose class is lung cancer or not lung cancer. So these conditional probabilities, like, so whether the lung cancer in particular class, family history and smoker, so how much these are affecting it. Family history and non-smoker, how much this is affecting. No family history and smoker, then how much it is affecting. No family history and no smoker, and how much it is affecting. Now these values, as I told you, can be given by human expert or can be learned if you have a very large data set by using neural networks. Once these values are known to you, now the same thing, same earlier, you are just multiply. So here you can use these conditional probabilities rather than the normal probability. So whatever, so these conditional values can be used to modify your overall algorithms. So in this way, we actually use a naive Bayesian algorithm. So from today's lecture, you have to take what is a takeaway. You need to learn that the basic theory behind this. You need to know that whenever we are calculating probability, so the main thing is the likelihood that we are calculating, multiply with the prior, divide by the evidence. So evidence, if it is uniform, we are ignoring. Prior, if it is, we are considering again, they are not equally likely, then we can ignore. And attributes, if we assume that they are not dependent on each other, then it becomes naive Bayesian algorithm. So when you go through this, you go through the example that I have given to you. So that example clearly shows that it is very easy to implement. But again, from the disadvantages, we know that we have taken some assumptions to make Bayesian theorem to naive Bayesian. And that also answers why it is called naive Bayesian, because we have taken two main assumptions, that classes are independent and attributes are independent of each other. And then one of the way to go away is using a Bayesian belief network. So where human expert can give their knowledge, and that can be used to improve the overall algorithm.